Our third theme is that after a short break, that the bull market should resume. I should point out with this theme, that doesn't mean we go straight up. I think we as investors have started to get used to this concept that volatility should be low and equities should just climb month in and month out. That's not the equity market. If we look historically, equities are volatile. Part of investing and getting the premium return you get for equities is putting up with that volatility and that risk. So we do think that 2019, the bull market returns. However, that doesn't mean a straight up market. As we look at last year, here's the break. In 2018, we look at that fourth quarter drop off the dotted line. We had a big pullback early in the year. We recovered, we made new highs, and then we saw our normal pullback in September, October. The difference is, as you see on the chart, in prior markets, in the long-term median returns, markets always tend to go up in November and December. And this year it was different. They went straight down. So we have this washout that occurred. What's interesting is the hottest stocks got hit the hardest. This next chart shows the FANG stocks, your Facebook, Apple, Amazon, Netflix, Google stocks versus the S&P 500 return. As we'll see, in the middle of the year, there was a massive premium for FANGs. These tech stocks were running away. As a matter of fact, if we go back to our quarterly reviews, you'll hear us consistently talking about the massive overvaluation in the FANG stocks and that there is no such thing as a sure thing. And the fourth quarter proved that. These stocks got beat up and there was really some damage done in the FANG stocks. And so the gap between those stocks and the rest of the market started to come back. Now, by the way, the S&P 500, that return was higher than the rest of the market. So there's still this narrow band of stocks in the S&P that are driving all the return. The FANG stocks, that one group has now returned back. They were the biggest winners. They were also the biggest hit on the market in the fourth quarter. So we had a bear market and we had a reasonably good economy and earnings grew at a double-digit pace. So if price goes down and earnings go up, what that means is the market just got a lot cheaper. So when we go through these markets where we see price declining and a bear market and the worst December in the market's history, it's easy to get nervous and say, maybe we should step aside. We're taking a step back and looking at this, and what we see on this next chart is PEs of the market over time. And so one of our themes last year was that the PE of the S&P 500 looked a little frothy. It wasn't necessarily a big buy market. It wasn't massively overpriced, but it looked a little high. Well, as we'll see in the chart at the end of the year, those PEs came down dramatically. Again, the economy did well, earnings went up, price went down. The whole market got a lot cheaper. How much cheaper? Take a look at the table on the bottom. Russell 2000 PEs down 22%. 2000 value, 22%, 2500. Everything here is 20% roughly cheaper than what it was at its high. So opportunistic, yes, we think so. Some of the areas that were hit harder and therefore, by the way, giving us even better value, small cap stocks. As we see on this chart, the bottom is earnings growth and the left is how far down they are from their high. So on the left top corner, you see the big stocks, Russell 1000, 1000 growth, 1000 value. Those are the biggest stocks in the marketplace. Well, they have the slowest growth rates and they came down the least. Now go to the far right bottom and you'll see the Russell 2000. That's small cap stocks. They actually have the best forward growth earnings estimates and yet they came down the most. So if earnings are going to grow and the price is down, that means those stocks got a lot cheaper in the marketplace. That's something we're looking to take advantage of. International stocks have been and continue to be very inexpensive. Now, that's a position we started to take last year. Did well in the fourth quarter, not as good in the third quarter. But as we take a look at where they stand, this chart shows international stocks over time. The orange bars are what's called a two standard deviation move. In other words, when it gets close to the orange bar at the top, international stocks tend to be more expensive relative to the U.S. When they get close to the bottom, they're very inexpensive. So this chart goes all the way back to 2002, and as we can see, when this bar was at the top, international was more expensive, and U.S. outperformed after those time periods. Now take a look at where we are today. We are as low as we have seen in terms of valuations relative to the U.S. for international stocks. That says buying opportunity to us. That says there is value. The key to this is we need to be patient. These things take time to unwind, but what the chart also shows is once they start to unwind, they tend to be very, very long cycles. Some interesting data around the stock market and are more reasons for us to be a little optimistic. This next chart shows 15% or greater corrections when there is no recession. This is an interesting table on the right. We'll see 66, 78, 87, 98, 2010, and 11 were all years where we had these significant corrections, but we didn't have a recession. Take a look at the returns, 3 months, 6 months, 9, 12, and 18 months out from those corrections, and you'll see these are not small recoveries. These are pretty big double-digit gains. And so if we're not heading into recession, and if the economy is going to continue to do well and earnings are going to continue to grow, that says that the market is really primed and is more opportunistic than it is concerning.